So we'll say that we go, leave the history, we will go to a different question. What do the Indian texts reveal about the Indian's understanding of science? Or what was the nature of scientific knowledge according to, what is the method of acquiring scientific knowledge, what is the nature of science? On this, of course this is a very big subject, I will give you some interesting tidbits. Now first thing about Indian texts is that they look very different from texts that we see of science elsewhere. It is, they do not indulge largely, I am talking of the classical texts, including texts written 100, 200 years ago. They largely talk of procedures, methods, rather than talking, giving you propositions or a series of truths or a series of principles. There will be a few principles, but largely it's set of rules and procedures. And these procedures are generally called prakriya, sadhana, karma, parikarma, karana, upaya, kriya. So this is the way, in fact, even Indian philosophical texts actually talk of the shastra vidhi, the procedures taught in shastra. So that's the way it is.
Is it like algorithm?
It is like algorithm. Algorithm is a systematic procedure, but that is one of calculation. But the procedure can be a procedure for cure, procedure can be a procedure for establishing a pillar, a procedure for finding a direction. So, procedure for everything. Now, second thing that you will see in Indian scientific texts is that they very clearly define the sort of the delimitations of a particular discipline. So, as I mentioned, the science of language. If you take a modern book on science of language, they'll first start talking about what is language, what is thought, what is mind, is there a relation between thought. So all these are of course important questions, but Panini's grammar does not start with any of this, nor does Patanjali's Mahabhashya start with these kind of questions. They are important, maybe they'll be discussed in their appropriate context. The purpose of grammar was to enable, as I said, a very mundane purpose, but a very difficult purpose, to derive all valid Sanskrit utterances from certain basic constituents on the basis of a certain number of rules. Mathematicians also called their discipline as computation, ganana, ganita, and that was calculation with numbers or figures or algebraic symbols, etc. Astronomers fixed their purpose as finding time, place, direction, observing the motion of celestial bodies. The Ayurvedic physicians set their goal of their discipline is amelioration of diseases of the sick and protection of the health of the healthy. Swasthasya, swasthyam, and the amelioration of the diseases of the sick. So such clear characterization enabled them to set up reasonable frameworks which were not final. Of course, you will have to, if your purposes sort of enlarge or if your things, you can alter them and then go on continuously improving upon them. The next thing is that the general understanding in India is the sciences of language and the Nyaya Vaisheshika philosophy are at the basis of all the shastras. That is, someone who wants to know any shastra very deeply, he will have to have some acquaintance with Panini's Shabda Shastra and also Kanada, which means the science of the logic of Nyaya and the metaphysics of Vaisheshika. This one should have a good grasp before studying any other shastra if one wants to go deep in them. So the modern Indologists have also realized that in Indian thought, the place that Panini occupies is something very similar to the place that Euclid occupies in the Western knowledge tradition. That it is thought that someone who knows Euclid really knows the method of science. Is the way that West would believe since the time of the Greeks. Whereas in India, the one who understands the method of Panini is given a similar kind of. Now, in understanding the method of Panini, his commentators, and the most important one is Patanjali, they are very clear what Panini is attempting. So first, Patanjali says, how do we go about teaching language? If I have to tell you, these are all the valid words. Of course, the ultimately correct way is to list all the valid words. But listing all the valid words is not possible. So he says it in this way, that Brihaspati started reciting all the valid words to Indra, and he could not do it even after 100,000 divine years. Each divine year is 360 human years. So then Patanjali says, so how do we go about it? So the main principle is try and formulate some general rules. But now at the moment when he is talking of general rules, Patanjali also says you try to formulate appropriate rules of exception also. Kashchit ah, kim punastat, what is the method by which we can go about? Utsarga apavadav, kashchit utsarga kartavyaha, kashchit apavada. Utsarga is general rule and apavada, it is like supposing you want to draw a complicated map today on the computer. You must sort of put some polygon, approximate, and then you draw that. Then what is the remaining portion? You again put a polygon. So it is like that. So he Patanjali goes into great detail about this. We will not go. Another important principle that Patanjali is enunciating, what is the established relation between word and its meaning? Where is it established? And the answer is in the world, lokataha. Katham punarjnayate siddhaha shabdo artha sambandhasyeti. And then he gives again an illustration that if you want parts, you go to a potter and ask him to make some parts for you. But if you want words, you start making them yourself. You really don't go to ask anybody for them. That this capacity you develop yourself. That and this relation between words and meaning is what is established in the world. So these are some of the basic methodological principles which characterize what the way Patanjali goes about doing things. That we do want to sort of take up this complex task of characterizing all valid utterances, and that we know is something which is there in the world, and we can only make some general rules, and while making general rules we should always keep in our mind that there will be exceptions also, and we will make exceptional rules and then proceed in that manner. Then the question comes that having worked out such a wonderful grammar which would have really happened over a very long period of tradition, that Panini is able to do with these 4000 rules and all the Shiva Sutras and everything, he is able to sort of characterize the classical Sanskrit of his period and also say how different it is from the Vedic Sanskrit of the Vedas. Indian grammarian's understanding is still that Panini's grammar is just one approach to characterizing the valid utterances. That here is Bhartrihari, who is writing a major text on philosophy of grammar around 400 AD. Exactly he is saying the grammatical method of Panini is only a means, it's an upaya. And this upaya you should acquire, but I have understood what are all the grammatical words, you need not bother about this upaya. But more importantly, you should realize there is no limitation on the kind of upaya that you need to take recourse to if you want to do this, as long as it does the job. Kashchid acharyaha panini virichitena lakshana shastrena shabdana adhigacchati kashchid anyena iti na niyama. So they were already in at the time of 4th century, there was Aindra Vyakarana, Jainendra Vyakarana, etc. It's not that these people are saying Panini's grammar is no good, we are leaving it. They are fierce dependents of Panini. But at the same time they say that philosophically Panini's grammar is also a means for actually arriving at all the valid utterances. So they are not willing to commit to the uniqueness and universality of Panini's Ashtadhyayi, whose reputation, whose efficacy was unsurpassed in 500. And this is something which again is stated even in 1700. Nagesha Bhatta, who is discussing the philosophy of the science of language in much more profounder terms, in much greater detail, he is trying to explain that all the concepts that are included in the grammatical science, they are our concepts. They are concepts which we have made. Of course, they correspond to something in reality, but they are not the reality themselves. They are understood by us in our use of these concepts. So, prakriti, pratyaya, anvaya, by using the method of anvaya and vitireka, the grammarians have come up with all this. And the upayas, grammatical derivations, are only for the realization of the desired result, and they are otherwise unrestricted. And the meaning rests in things like sentences, and only the sentences have meaning. And to use them, I think the Sanskrit has that thing. Prakriti pratyaya vibhagam pravibhajya kalpita abhyam anmaya vyatireka abhyam tatadartha vibhagam shastra matra visham parikalpayanti. These teachers have sort of imagined all this and given it to us. All other things are also imaginary, and the real meaning lies in the actual sentences, and the grammar is a device that we make use. And upaya pratipatyarthaha upayaha avyavasthitaha. That is, there is really no restraint or sort of constraint on the kind of theories you can make. So we will go from grammar now to Indian epistemology, Nyaya Shastra. So in Indian Nyaya Shastra, it has four means of valid knowledge. All of you would have heard about them. Pratyaksha is what is in English where we call it perception, anumana inference, upamana analogy, and tradition or authoritative text or authoritative testimony of reliable people. The basic scheme of inference in Nyaya is of this nature. Parvato vahnimat, mountain has fire, dhumat, because it has smoke. Yatra dhumas tatra vahni, wherever there is smoke, there is fire, as in the kitchen. This mountain is similar, hence. So, this is an instance of inductive reasoning. This is a standard instance of, this is not an example of an Aristotelian deductive syllogism. The basic panchavayava vakya, it is called Nyaya, is a standard example of inductive reasoning that we employ all the time in sciences. And the crucial thing is this. This is called the vyaptik jnana. The understanding that wherever there is fire, smoke, there is fire. And a huge amount of Navya Nyaya goes to try and formulate this. This is called the theory of universal quantification in modern mathematical logic. And Indian logic is able to achieve it by a method which is very different from the extensive method, say theoretical kind of method, that the modern mathematical logic has come. Even today, there are many, many aspects of Navya Nyaya which need to be understood from the appropriate perspective. But something much more important is the principle that the Indian logicians are enunciating. For them, inference is something that is subordinate to perception and tradition. Pratyakshagama ashritam anumanam sa anvicha. So, the main thing is, in all investigations, inference is not what is primary. What is primary is perception, and next what is primary is the tradition or authoritative text or authoritative testimony. And inference that does not contradict is something is what you should go for. And this is, as we will see in the medical text also, emphasize this. These are some philosophical issues, I will not go into that. The basic understanding in India is that all these pramanas are sort of, they have a interlinking. In Western philosophical thought, it was thought that there is some knowledge that comes through the senses, and there is some other knowledge which comes through a special faculty in our mind called reason. So this rationality was attributed to a special faculty of which is characteristic of the humans, which no other beings do not have. And in fact, according to Greece, the slaves had it in an inferior proportion and women in a corresponding small proportion. But this faculty is a separate faculty, and sense perception, and what is achieved by reason is always superior. I mean, these were all major notions of the Greek rationalist thought. Anyway, we will not go to that. But there is nothing of all that in Indian philosophy. Anumana is inference. It is actually a knowledge which follows a perceptual knowledge that you see smoke on the mountain, and another knowledge which you have gained by experience that wherever there is smoke, there is fire, and then you sort of conclude that the mountain has fire. So this Then another crucial factor of Indian logic was that terms which were unsubstantiated cannot be used in a logical argument. Similarly, false premises cannot be used as a part of a logical argument. And this makes, as you know in mathematics, most of you might know, that one of the major ways of proving results in mathematics, what is called proof by contradiction. That is not something that would be allowed by Nayayikas. I will say something about it a little bit later. Now, we come to proofs in Indian mathematics. Next. So the ancient texts, of course, enunciated results. And the proofs were part of instruction, and they started being written down in the form of commentaries. And the oldest known commentary of Aryabhatiya due to Bhaskara, one in 629 AD, has some instances of argumentation. But one of the first texts which has very detailed proofs is the text of Bhaskaracharya II, Siddhanta Shiromani. He himself wrote down the Vasana Bhashya. And there he tries to explain why he is enunciating the proofs. So this verse is enunciating Madhyadhyam Yusadam Yadatra Ganitam. Thus Yopapatim Vina. Upapati is the name for proof in Indian mathematics. He says, whatever mathematics you learn, if the proofs are not provided, if you are not capable of providing proofs, Praudhim Praudha Sabhasu Daiti Ganako. The mathematician will not be given any substantial respect in an assembly of mathematicians. That is, he will not be accepted as a professional mathematician. Nissam Shayona Swayam. Nor will he be free of doubt himself. So, the two crucial factors which come in as a reason for supplying proof is one, that the result that you write should be acceptable to other mathematicians. And the second, that you should be free of doubts about it yourself and should be able to clarify whatever doubts anybody has on that. So, it is not that proof is something that once and for all establishes unquestionable truth of a proposition. That ideal of proof is not the one that is being stated. If you see the commentary of Euclid due to Proclus. So the main thing that he is saying about demonstration is that it should come in an irrefragable sequence. That it should come in an unquestionable sequence of from true results, you go to true results, to go to true results. And the whole process should be unquestionable. And that is what a proof is. Here it is something that, and even today in practicing, mathematicians do this only. I mean, the famous proof of Fermat's last theorem by Andrew Weitz. After he wrote the paper, I think a couple of versions had to be written before it became acceptable to all others as an acceptable proof, and it was published 1 or 2 years later. This always happens that you, because most people know that there are some intermediate arguments missing, but they have to be supplied, how that is to be supplied. But the ideal of proof is something which almost says that every step in this should be absolutely crystal clear and unquestionable. So that kind of an ideal of proof, they don't even state. Actually, a study of Indian mathematical texts will show you that they supply proofs in these commentaries and the proofs go in a sequence. You go from established results to next established results. But their understanding is the proofs are to convince the students, other fellow mathematicians. Sometimes the proof may involve things like cutting and pasting or doing an experiment. Even those are, it's not a very formal kind of an exercise. Most crucial thing is, proof by contradiction is not given a high status. There are two things you can do with proof by contradiction. You can show something does not exist by contradiction. That is generally all right. But a large part of mathematics uses proof by contradiction to show the existence of something. Then they are actually proving that the non-existence of that thing contradicts whatever else that you know, therefore that might exist. But that does not give you any handle on how to approach that. So this has been questioned by mathematicians through history, and it's a major movement in 20th century mathematics, known as the constructivist approach to. So Indians generally took that kind of it. Then final thing is, they do not believe in putting down all the axioms at the beginning. That does not mean that Indian mathematicians are not cheating. That only means that you cannot really, there are so many commonly shared assumptions that we have, that if we start listing all of them, it will not be possible. So you will have to list what is very crucial for this discipline for the time. And when we start showing the results, if you point out something else has been assumed, then I will try and show you that, no, that's also well known, isn't it clear that this is true. So that you can, this putting down all the axioms at one time is very important in a scheme where you are using proof by contradiction. Because then there you assume something else and show that this contradicts these axioms, that adds to your knowledge and things like that. It's a very different methodology, which was initiated first by Aristotle and then followed by Euclid. And that is not a system that Indians followed. And in fact, they didn't believe that there are axiomatic truths also. Any truth can be questioned. So the entire approach that Indians took to mathematical truth is like mathematical truths like are like truths in natural science. 2 plus 2 is equal to 4 is similar to pressure times volume is proportional to temperature for an ideal gas or something like that. Now about astronomy. So in astronomy also, the text of astronomy, after setting down the astronomical model, they will again say that all these concepts that we are using, they are conceptual entities that we have made, and they are there for us to derive these positions of planets, and that is what should tally with observation. And so in working out these models, you can be fairly relaxed and employ different kinds of procedures and see what works. Whereas if you read something like the Greek text of Ptolemy, he starts by saying what is the correct way in which the heavenly motion should occur. So he says circle is the most perfect orbit, and therefore the perfect entities, this heavenly object, they have to move in circle. Uniform motion is something which is ideal, and so they should move in, have uniform. This is the way the scientific text proceeds. The next thing Indian astronomers say is that you should continuously put your texts to test and revise them, because the scientific laws that you discover, they are not the ultimately true natural laws that you have discovered once and for all. They are subject to correction, they are subject to continuous refinement and correction, and the changes can occur due to the error of the teacher, error of the pupil, the approximateness of the parameters and various factors. Then Nilakanta Somayaji, the doyens of 15th, 16th century science in India, has written extensively on the nature of astronomical knowledge and the making of astronomical theories. And in Aryabhatiya Bhashya, he explains how Parameshwara observed 5 years and then arrived at his Drigganita, which is fairly accurate for his time, that's 1430. This is a work Nilakanta is writing in 1502. And then he says, therefore, everyone should instruct their students only after due examination. Ataha, parikshyaiva sarvairapi shishyebhyaha upadeshtavyam tada sati. If we do that, na visamvadaha kadachidapi bhavishyati. If you do that, there will not be too much discordance between the theory and observation. Jayamanasyapi parihajyatvat. If such discrepancy arises, you will then know how to correct it, because you have taught after making. There is a very detailed tract called Jyotir Mimamsa by Nilakanta, which is very important in this context. It's a long quotation, but there are some very interesting points that Nilakanta is. First, Nilakanta starts with the question that you start calculating by the parameters and the method given in Aryabhatiya. You find that the results are not tallying. Then he says, how can this happen? Now Aryabhatta himself has said that you should do examination of your theory. But ordinary people don't understand. Some people indeed believe that Brahma instructed Aryabhatta the true motion of celestial bodies because of the great penance tapas Aryabhatta had did. And so the parameters given in Aryabhatiya cannot be questioned. Because how can Brahma be questioned? Then he says, you are being a fool if you think this way, that Brahma coming and teaching Aryabhatta is not the issue. Devata prasadam mati vaimalya hetureva. The grace of gods is only for attaining the clarity of intellect. And in fact, Aryabhatta himself tells you that it is by the clarity of my intellect I am able to refine upon the available science of astronomy and give you this. And so this pariksha is to be done continuously by disciples and the disciples. Then he says, Aryabhataya is important not because of the parameters or the procedures that it is teaching us. It is important because it is telling us this method of examination. How to examine, put the theories to examination. That is why it's important. And then he says that a recent commentator thought that the Pancha Siddhantas, which were true at one time, are not true today at all. And therefore all our calculations are going awry. So he says, what is the problem? That anyone who has learned the method of astronomy should know that the Siddhantas were valid for their times. So one should look for a Siddhanta that does not show discord with observations. And such testing should be done periodically during eclipses and conjunction of planets, etc. When the earlier Siddhanta showed discord, observation should be made and new Siddhanta should be enunciated. So main point is, the purpose of Shastra is to create in students the capacity for examining the motion of grahas. So purpose of Shastra is not to enunciate the ultimate true laws of motion of the grahas. The purpose of Shastra is to enunciate, enable the student to have this capacity. So, tasmat shishyanam grahagati samarthya padanameva Shastra prayojan. That's the kind of very long discourse by Nilakanta. Okay. So finally, the Ayurvedic physicians, they also talk at no end on the need for putting what is given in their text to continuous examination. So in the Ayurvedic text, the most important thing that a physician should have is a quality known as yukti. So Charaka talks of pratyaksha, anumana and shabda, and then he adds yukti. And then what is yukti? First he gives some examples that crops come about by proper conjunction of water flowing up the field, seed and seasons. The creators of the fetus is possible by proper conjunction of six dhatus. Fire comes about by using the two things while making the egg, things like that. So the medical science depends upon the four pillars: physician, materials, attendant and patient of good quality. So in that the physician should have yukti. So what is yukti? Yukti is the capacity of the intellect, according to Charaka, of seeing through the multiple causes that are relevant for a particular phenomenon to occur. So in that sense it's not very different from inference. It is a sophisticated inference, but it's a very specific characteristic that is very essential in the science of medicine. Whenever you make examination and want to understand the nature of the disease and want to understand in the kind of medicine that you want to give. So yukti is very, very essential in this entire science of medicine, and therefore it is being separately emphasized. Buddhi pashyati abhavat bahukarana yogajan yukti hi trikala sadhyeya trivarga sadhya. So bahukarana yogajan yabhavan pashyati sa buddhi hi yukti hi. Yukti is the special capacity of the intellect to be able to see through multiple causes, which is at the heart of medical science. Then these kind of things that an expert physician should never doubt through reasons the efficacy of drugs which have been established in practice and whose nature is well known. So even if you give hundreds or thousands of reasons, the ambashta groups cannot be made to start initiate purgative action. Sahasrenapi hetunan na ambashtadihi virecheye. Even if you have thousands of reasons, you cannot, meaning pratyaksha is something that always supersedes the anumana, the inference that you could make. Similarly, the text should not be taken very literally when you see in practice that there are instances where things are going in a different way. So this is again a very cardinal principle that a physician should be aware of. And in fact, the texts do advocate a very open approach to knowledge. The Ayurvedic texts right at the beginning say that the people in forest, the shepherds, the cowherds, many of them know medicine by their form, by their looks, by their nature. But they may not know them through the scientific principles of Ayurvedic tradition. And therefore a physician should always be aware of this knowledge and try and incorporate them and enlarge his knowledge. So there is a lecture that the teacher is supposed to give to a new student when he is being initiated. It's a long discourse, at the end of which the teacher says, Nacharivas Yasti Tutaram Ayurvedasya Param. There is no limit to the science of Ayurveda. Tasmad apramattaha shashvad abhiyogam asya gachet. So diligently practice this science and try to learn good things from whatever practices that you see in others. Krishno hi loko buddhimatam acharyaha shatruscha abuddhimatam. The whole world indeed is a teacher for the wise, and it's indeed an enemy for the foolish. And another something very similar, that Charaka explains that this entire Shastra, that means the methodology and the procedures taught in the text, this is something that is like a light which illuminates a given situation. The actual understanding is coming by your intellect. Shastram jyoti prakashartham darshanam buddhira. There is nothing mechanical about the practice of medicine. Even if you have mastered the text, there is nothing mechanical. Then it is your mind which is to finally perceive the actual state of things. The Shastra can only illuminate and throw light. And a physician who is endowed with this can indeed. So this is the kind of approach to theorization that is characteristic that you find in all the sciences. I mean, they have given you instances from linguistics to mathematics to astronomy to medicine. That scientific theorization is something which always leads to conclusions which are useful, which are valid, but they should be continuously tested. So you have a pragmatic approach to scientific theory, that you are not looking, you are not even conceiving of universal laws that are valid once and for all, that having discovered them, you have sort of discovered the mind of God who has created the universe in that manner. So that is not the kind of philosophy that any of the Indian Shastras are taking in the domain of practical and theoretical sciences, including mathematics. Second thing is an open-ended approach, that you have to continuously revise your theory. You have to be continuously aware of parameters that you have not seen. You have to be continuously aware of knowledge that is available elsewhere, and sort of. And there is no reason that if something does not fit in your theories, that should be idiotic, that is false knowledge, that is devilish knowledge, that is wrong knowledge, that should be discarded, that should be prevented from being operated. In fact, India became a victim of that kind of a philosophy starting from about 13th century, and much more so in 19th century. After all, what is Macaulay saying? That he was not saying that the Indian sciences are no good for us Englishmen. He said that in these Indian sciences are no good for you Indians. And so that is the kind of sort of onslaught on knowledge. That a knowledge system which is so open, which is able to accommodate divergent knowledges, within itself it is able to accommodate different kinds of viewpoints. That's the kind of onslaught of a theoretical, so a philosophical framework, which was so wedded to their theories that at each moment they thought they had the absolute truth. Of course, to discover hundreds or thousand years later, they did not have anything approaching absolute truth. That was the kind of thing of which we have become victim of. And therefore, we are victim of it even today. I mean, the wise thing that I quoted in the sort of note I gave on Professor Hayashi's statement on studying non-Western sciences was this understanding that this modern science is, there is nothing universal, absolute or eternal about it. This is subject to change. And how it should change depends on how well we understand sciences and the way sciences come about and the way sciences go about. And there is a huge corpus of science and knowledge which survives in our tradition, which is continuing in various manners, If we understand its spirit, we will be able to handle modern knowledge also appropriately and contribute to a future world knowledge systems of various kinds, which will be much more pragmatic in the sense they will be based upon these kind of philosophies than on the kind of philosophies that we are accustomed to. So with this, I conclude whatever I have said. Thank you.